Hey, good morning, everyone. Today we got quite a few topics to cover to talk about. So as you can see from the title of this slide, we're talking about recursion, which is a very important, very powerful problem solving technique and also algorithm design technique. And the second part of lecture, of today's lecture, I'll talk about very briefly, actually just to give your guys a brief introduction to algorithm analysis. And then we'll talk about two categories of the algorithms, as you know, which are very important. One is about searching, another one is about sorting, so two types of algorithms. So we got a quite a full agenda for today. All right, part one, we're talking about recursion. What is a recursion? Recursion basically is a very powerful technique which basically is to break down a complex problem into smaller problem, but of the same type. I'll give you an example what's mean by that, you know, and then solve them individually. So, some program languages support recursion, some program language don't, you know. For C and C++ program, I'm only interested in C++. C++ is a program language that support recursion, all right? So what do you mean by recursion or recursive function? So recursive, so this is the definition. So basically a function or method or function is called recursive if the function call itself directly or indirectly. So I will give you an example very shortly. So when you define a function, inside of the function definition, you call it itself. This will be called recursion, right? So that function is called recursive function. But there's another way. It does not have to call itself directly, could be indirectly. So for example, we have a function f1, we have another function f2. So function f1 call function f2, maybe function f2 and call, in function f2 call function f1. So f1 call itself indirectly. So this is also called recursive function. All right. So recursive function is a very, very important programming technique. Because as you will see in a minute, so sometimes you know the recursion can map into our thinking, you know, perfectly. So there are some problems in the real world. I will actually give you an example, which probably is very difficult to be solved using some other method, but very straightforward, you know, to use a recursive function to solve it because, you know, by the nature of the problem, it's a sort of a recursive problem. So you can use a recursion to solve it very quickly. Okay, I will give you an example. So if you want to use a recursive function to solve a problem, you need to address two issues. The number one issue, you need to find out what we call base case. So base case basically is the basic, as the name implies, is the basic cases. Right? It could be one base case, could be more, or two, or maybe more, a couple of base cases. Right? This is the one issue you need to address. Another issue is you need to find a recursive case. So how would you, when we say recursive case, so basically is, let's say the size of the problem is n. So when I say size, for example, if we're talking about sorting, that's the total number of elements in the array or in the list. right? That's the size of the problem, right? So if we want to solve a problem of size n using recursive function or use a recursion in general, so you need to find a way how to change the problem of size n into a problem of smaller size. It's still the same problem, but smaller size. Maybe size n minus 1, maybe say size n minus 2, right? So basically, the basic idea is if we want to find a solution to the function of size n, then I convert it, just an example. Does not have to be in this particular way. So I transfer the problem into a problem of solving, you know, the same problem, this is still the same problem, size n minus 1 plus doing something else, right? So if I can find the solution for size minus 1, I can use the solution and, you know, do something else, you know, to build a solution for the problem of size n, right? That sounds a little bit confusing, but I give you an example. So this is an example. This is a factorial. So I assume you guys are happy with factorial. So factorial basically is the this is the definition for factorial. It's the production of all the positive integers less than or equals to n. So this is the definition. Factorial n equals to n times n minus 1 times n minus 2 times blah, blah, blah times 1, right? This is the by definition. So if we want to find define our function to calculate factorial n, that's the size n, right? So we can do this. So we can transfer this problem into, okay. We can transfer this problem, the original problem, into this. So in order to find the factorial n, this is what we call a recursive step. So this is equal to n times factorial n minus 1. So because this part is n minus 1, factorial n minus 1, right? So this is the what we call recursive step, right? So if we want, I say that again, if we want to solve the problem for size n, factorial size n, we convert it, you know, we transfer it to a problem of solving factorial n minus 1, of course, doing something else, right? So if we can find the factorial n minus 1, then we times n, then we get to the solution to factorial n. So this we call recursive step, right? This is the one issue. So we're talking about how to use recursive function to solve, to find a solution to the factorial value factorial problem, right? And then another issue is we need to find, for example, or we convert the problem of find factorial n into a problem of find factorial n minus 1. And then when we do this, when we find a solution to factorial n minus 1, we use the same idea, transfer into a problem of finding a solution to factorial n minus 2, and so on and so forth. But eventually, it must have an exit. Otherwise, it would be recursive forever. So the program never stop, right? So that's why we have at least the one base case. So the base case for this problem is when n equals to 0, factorial 0 equals to 1. Okay, then, so this is the function, right? So this is the factorial function. This is the solution to the problem. So the parameter is n, right? This is the size of the problem. That's only parameter. So if n equals to 1, we return 1. We know factorial 0 equals to 1, right? Otherwise, we return n times factorial n minus 1. This is the parameter. This is the argument. We pass n minus 1 into this. So this is a recursive function, example of a recursive function, as the function call itself. So this is a factorial n. When we define the factorial function, we call it itself. So this is a very, this is a typical recursive function, right? Then how this algorithm, how this function works, I show you. That left hand side is the function, right? So for example, when we make a function call, if we want to find the solution to factorial 3, we pass a parameter or argument 3 into that function. So n equals to 3. So as you can see from there, it's 3. Now we check, because n equals to 3, n is 3, right? So we check if 3 here, if 3 equals to 0, of course not. Then what we do is we go this way. We return 3, because n equals to 3, 3 times factorial 2. And 3 minus 1 gives 2, right? Do this. But we still don't know the solution to factorial 2. So there is another recursive call. So when we do this, this will reserve another recursive call for factorial, but this time it's factorial 2, right? Do the same. So now the parameter value or the argument is 2. So we check if n equals to 0 or if 2 equals to 0, of course not. Then we do the same, right? We return 2 where n equals to 2, right? N times factorial n minus 1, which is 1. Well, still don't know the solution, the value of factorial 1. So we need another recursive call. Right, but of course, this is done automatically by the compiler. You don't need to worry about that. All you need to do is to make a call to factorial 3. This will be done automatically, right? Now, factorial 1. So now n equals to 1. 1 does not equal to 0. So we do this 1 times factorial 0, right? With factorial 0, this will reserve another call, recursive call, of course. So now n equals to 0. 0 equals to 0, yes. Then we return 1. So we return 1 back to here, right? Now we got the value 1. And then 1 times 1, so we return 1 to the calling function. And then 1 times 1, because this 1 times 1 gives 1, return 1 back to its calling function, which is this. So return 1 to here. So now the return value is 1. 2 times 1 gives 2. And then return back to the calling function, right? Which is this one. Oh, sorry. This one. So now 3 times 2 gives 6. So 6 return back to the calling method. So depending on who actually make a call to factorial 3, they will return 6 to the calling method. All right, so this is how it works, recursive function works. So when you make a call to a recursive function, it will result in a number of recursive calls, potential number of like that, call one, another one, until they get to the base case. So once they find the base case, they return the value to one level up, until they call to the calling method, to the top calling method. For this instance, is factorial 3, right? This is how it works, right? So pretty simple. Any questions? So basically, whenever you want to use a recursive function, you need to address two issues. Number one, you need to find a base case. Otherwise, the program, from this example, you will know without a base case, the program would be make a recursive call forever, or always call, never stop, right? So you must have an exit, which is the basic case, right? We'll get a basic case, then we'll return all the way back to the top calling method, right? So this is how it works. Okay, there is a very typical example when we talk about recursion. This is a very, very famous example in computer science. For the computer science student, computer scientist, everybody knows what's mean by Tower for Hanoi. Did you hear that or not? Yes? Somebody say yes? Yes, okay, yeah. So for this problem, so basic problem, for those of you probably who don't know what the problem is, just to quickly tell you. So basically, it's something like a game, right? So it's you got some stick, we call the rules, right? So you got 1, 2, 3. Now you got some disks of different size. Okay, they stack on each other over there like this, right? Now your job is, this is the current where the stick are, you know, in this, for example, disks are in, on this road, right? Let's say A. Let's say this is A, this is B, and this is C. Okay, just give them labels. So your job basically is to move all the disks one by one. So every time you can only one move, you can, every time you move, you can move one disk. You cannot move the whole lot, right? So your objective is to move all the disks from here, which is we call the source destination, source location to its destination, for example, to C. You need to move all the disks from A to C. You can use this spell root, right? You can use this spell root. But there are some rules. For example, every time you can only move one disk at a time. You cannot move two at the same time. Number two, you cannot put a bigger disk on a smaller disk. So always put a smaller on a bigger, on the top of bigger. You, not the other way around. You cannot put a bigger one on the top of smaller one. Okay, this is the problem, all right? So for this problem, I probably give you only 1 minute to think about. If I ask you to write a program to solve this, to solve that problem, ask, let's say, C++ program to solve that problem, Tower of Hanoi, how would you do that? You don't have to actually do that, you just think about the idea. How would you do that? Can you give your guys only 1 minute of time? Yeah. Say second. You reduce what? Reduce stack.
Stacks. Yeah.
Use. Did you say using stacks? Okay. For this one, you cannot use any other data structures. So when you move, you cannot put the disk into somewhere else. You know, when you move, you have to move from one road to another. You cannot use any other temporary or that structures, right? You cannot hold, you cannot do that. I hold this one, I put this one, I can't do that. So every time you move, I have to move from one road to another, yes. The problem is you cannot put the bigger one on the top of a small one. Yes, you can treat it as a stack, you know, but the problem is how would you do that?
Even number,
odd number. Okay. You can try, probably that method does not work very well. You can try, so after the class, I would suggest your guys to challenge yourself by writing a recursive method. Okay, the solution I'm going to provide you is a recursive solution. But I would suggest use other method trying to solve the problem. What I can tell you is very challenging, very, very difficult, very hard to do that. But with recursion, very easy to solve this very difficult problem. Okay. Because of time limitation, I don't have time to give you two guys, you know, may spend too much time talking about, you know, possible solutions. But now, I just give you the solution, the recursive solution to you, all right? My solution to you, which is a recursive solution. Now, we use the recursive function. So how could we use a recursive function to find a problem? So whenever I just emphasize, I have already said that, I just emphasize again. So whenever we use a recursive function, so basically, number one, we need to find a base case. Number two, at least one base, could be two base cases, or maybe multiple base cases, that define, but at least one base case. And more important, you need to find a recursive step. So when I say, again, when I say recursive step is, how would you find a, you know, a solution to a problem of size n into a problem of size of n minus 1, or maybe n minus 2, or smaller problem, right? How would you do that, right? So this is the solution. So basically, for this one, what, so this is the where those disks are. So this is the destination. We want to move from A to C, right? So we can use this one. Yes, of course, yeah. One disk at a time. Yeah. Right. So, you can't do that. You can move it one at a time. You cannot move three disks together.
How do you get to the first step?
Oh. That's a good question. This will use the recursive call. So how would you solve this? Okay, let me finish this one first and then answer a question. Then we use the idea recursively. So how would you get, you know, from here to there? How would we get there? Then we use a recursive, okay. So for example, we use a recursive, this is a current location, and we use this one as a spell. And this is the destination, but this time we move three rather than originally four. Right, that we use it recursively. And then we transfer this problem into a problem of moving two disks and so on and so forth. Right, the idea. Okay, let me explain the idea first. And so how could we use the recursive function to solve that problem? This problem this is illustration, okay, this idea, right? So first of all, we need to transfer this problem into a problem of solving MS1 disks, right? This is how. So first step one, we move the top three. We got four together for four disks. We move the top three from A to B, right? This is the situation, right? How to do that, I'll tell you in a minute. And then I move the bottom disk from A to C directly. Right, this is the situation, right? That we don't need any spare, right? We can directly, because it's just a one disk, we can directly move from A to C, all right? And then finally, I move the three disks, which are currently in B, to C, use A as a spare rod, all right? So this is the idea, okay? So in this way, we build our recursive steps, right? We could build a recursive step, right? Then how would we solve these problems? How would we, for example, move the top three disks from A to B? Then we use the same idea. We use the idea recursively. So we move top three, we move n minus one disks from A to B. So initially it's from A to C, use B as a spell rod, right? But this one, we move the top three disks from A to B, use C as a spare rod. All right? And then how to solve this problem? We use the idea recursively. We change this problem into a problem of moving two disks. And then how to solve two disks problem? We use the idea recursively again. We transfer the problem into a problem of moving one disk. One disk, this is the basic case, just the one move. All right? So this is the basic idea. Okay, this is the algorithm in pseudocode, right? So basically, when n equals to 1, which is the basic case, when e equals to 1, we simply move the disk from A to C, right? And finish, stop, terminate the program. Otherwise, that's what to move the top MS1 from A to B, and then move the bottom one from A to C, and then move the MS1 disk from B to C, right? So this is what we just discussed. This algorithm, this is the implementation. So see the program, how simple the program is, right? This program is as simple as that. So we have five parameters. We have, this is the size of the program, this is the total number of disks, which is N. And also we use another one to count. You don't have to do this because we want to count the total number of moves, right? Total number of moves. So we use another one. So you can ignore this one if you're not interested in this one. Anyway, then we have three rows, you know. We have A, B, C, but we call the source, destination, and the spell, right? So when equals to one, we simply, this is the basic case, we simply move for this one from move, you know, from source to destination, just the one move. We use this one as a counter, right? So every time we move, this is the basic move, we increase the value by one. So this is the second parameter. Now these are recursive call. So this function name is move and it call itself three times. All right? Three times. Well, for the basic one, they still move, but this, when we move, the number of disks is one, which eventually we'll make a call to this, right? So we actually, these are recursive call, actually, this function move call itself three times. But this is a reduction step, right? So we change the problem of size n into three problems, two of them are size n minus one problem of size one. Right, this recursive call, right? This is very easy, right? It's very easy to understand. So as you can see, that problem can naturally map into a recursive function, right? So this is very, so you can, so this is the main program which demonstrate, which, you know, make a call or client program, which make a call to this one, to the disk, right? So this is not very important anyway. For example, we use ABC, we use a counter, you know, and this is more, you know, what then we finally make a call to this move, a recursive, which is a recursive function. Right, so this is just the, some sample output. For example, when I put one, or only have two disks, right? So this is the output from that program. So we move the top disk from A to B, and then top disk from A to C, and then top disk from B to C, right? Then you find a solution to a problem of size two, right? So of course, if you want to, so this is a output won't enter when the size of the number of disks is three. So this is the solution. So if you following those steps, you know, this operation step by step, you can find a solution to the Tower of Hanoi problem of size 2, Tower of Hanoi problem of size 3, or Tower of problem of size n, any number, all right? Any questions about this one? The idea is, or again, very, very, the core idea is, basic case, recursive step, right? Once you find the basic case and the recursive step, you find the solution, pretty much, all right? Again, and we don't have too much time to talk about this, but if I strongly encourage you guys to challenge yourself by writing something like an iterative rather than recursive function to solve that problem. I can tell you in advance, it's going to be very, very challenging, okay? You can try, so you can have appreciation, you know, why recursive function is so important, it's so powerful, yes?
Is a recursive function always factorial?
Sorry? No. So this is a solution to another problem. Tower Hanoi, this is also, you know, you can use it for many different problems. Actually, this week's practical, there are a number of other applications where you use recursive function. So this is just a second example, right? Tower Hanoi and factorial, so we have already given you two examples. There are many examples in the real world where you can use a recursive function. So it's a very powerful technique. Okay. All right. The next topic. Actually, algorithm analysis is a very important one, but for the computer science people, actually, this is a separate object, typically, which you need to runs basically for one semester. So here we only use a few minutes to talk about this. So what I'm trying to say is what I can do today is to give your guys some concept about algorithm analysis. So I don't think we have time to talk about algorithm analysis techniques in very detail today. It's a separate subject, right? Mainly for postgraduate students, you know, so just the one, you need one subject to talk about algorithm detail in very detail. Anyway, so it give your guys today only, give your guys a brief, a very high level introduction to algorithm analysis very quickly. So quickly recap the definition for algorithm. I believe you guys know what's mean by algorithm, what's the difference between algorithm and a program, okay? So just to quickly recap the concept. Algorithm basically is a step-by-step procedure following which you can solve a problem, right? This is what we call the algorithm. Algorithm is a solution to a problem, right? If you're following the steps, you know, step one, step two, following the steps, you can solve a problem. So it's about problem solving. One algorithm can be implemented in different program languages. For example, for the Tower of Hanoi problem. So I actually gave your guys an algorithm here before, give your program, right? So this is the algorithm in English. This is the implementation of the algorithm in C++, right? So one algorithm, for example, this algorithm can also be implemented in Java, in C, in other any other program languages that support recursion, right? So the difference between algorithm and programs is algorithm is solution to a problem, a computational problem. Programs are just the implementations, you know, program, just implementations of the algorithm. So algorithm is independent from any program languages, right? So this is the relationship, just to make it very clear when I talk about algorithm analysis. Okay, back to here. Then there is an issue, right? There is some issue over there. Okay. Algorithm can be represented in different ways. For example, as I already said, we can present an algorithm, represent an algorithm in, for example, in a natural language like English, right? But it's not a very, but this normally we don't use English. Why? Because it's not a very accurate, right? Sometimes one sentence could be, one statement could be interpreted in different ways. It's not a very accurate language, right? So that's why we don't normally we don't use English to describe the program the algorithms. Another option is we use a program language. Program language, yes, very accurate, right? So if not accurate, the computer will not able to, you know, to follow, right? It has to be very accurate. But the problem is if you use any particular program language to document or to represent our algorithm, for the people who don't know the program language, maybe not able to understand the logic, how it works, right? So there's another problem. So we actually use the very popular, so we very common, we use a pseudocode. We use a pseudocode to describe our programming, describe our algorithm, for algorithm description, right? So the code we use, for example, is a code that actually is a pseudo code, right? So it's not actually real code, like a C++ code or Java code. It's not code. But the syntax looks pretty much the same with, you know, the most of the program language, particularly in concurrent statement. So it's a pretty, you know, accurate, right? It's a pseudo code anyway, so I don't want to spend too much time. The problem is, for example, now if I have one problem, I get all of you to design an algorithm to solve that problem. Maybe different people will come up with different solutions, right? So the question is, if everyone provides a solution to me for the same problem, how would I know which algorithm is better than others? Which is the best algorithm? which is the worst algorithm. How would you do that? Okay, which means I need some criteria, right? Otherwise, how would I know, for the assignment, why some guy got 7, some guy got 5? So what is the criteria, right? So the criteria typically we use here is 2 criteria. Number 1 is the computation time. So for example, for the sieve problem, one guy can solve the problem in, for example, only 1 minute, another guy needed 2 minutes plus or something like that. Of course, in terms of computation, the algorithm 1 is better than algorithm 2, right? For the same problem, of course. Another one is the space. How much memory space utilization. How much memory does your algorithm need, right? So when you implement an algorithm in a programming language, you maybe need a very large memory in order to run your program. Where another guy also uses a much smaller space, right? So there basically we use the 2 criteria, but we always have some trade-off. This is pretty much true. We cannot get one without a compromise another as always. So sometimes you want to get a little bit of quicker computation time, and you need more space, more memory, more memory. If you want to use less memory, probably speed will be compromised, will be slowed down, right, as always, right? 2 criteria for algorithm analysis. There is another idea. So for example, now in the real world, now your guys find some real world computational problems, and in your group, all of you have designed or figured out a solution to the problem. Now, I have already told that. Now, whose solution is the best? Which solution should we adopt? We should use in the real world problem? Okay, of course, you probably tell me, okay, we can use the 2 criteria, computing time, space utilization, which is okay, but probably not a very good idea. Why? Because in order to do the evaluation, when you want to pick up one, you would have to get everybody implementing your algorithm. Some algorithm are very complex. Maybe take quite a while, maybe a few days, a few weeks to implement before you can make a decision to say, which algorithm, which solution is better. So this is not a very practical, not a very good idea. So that's why we have algorithm analysis, right? So how to solve that problem? So there are many solutions. One way to solve the problem is to use we call the big O notation. So rather than, we're not very interested in the very accurate computing time, how much exactly the space will be used by your algorithm. We'll talk about algorithm, right? So instead, we don't want to, because implementation sometimes is very expensive and takes time, right? So rather than get implemented and then we say how much space do we need, what's the computing time it would be, then we actually do some analysis. We analyze the program to say roughly or approximately how much time the algorithm. But you probably ask me, how much time depending on the size of the problem. If this, for example, for Tower of Hanoi, if the size is very big, of course, take a longer time. For the smaller problem, of course, take a short time. That's for sure, right? So this is not a very good idea. So what we do is, okay, I just use this one as an example. So we look at what we are interested in is how, for example, now we only talk about computation time, okay? Because it's more important in most of the applications, it's more important. And for space utilization, you can use a similar idea, right? So I'm only concentrate use one criteria, which is computation time. So for the computation time, rather than look at exactly the computation time, we look at we'll talk about not a program, algorithm, right? How the computation time of your algorithm increase when the size of the problem increase. Okay, we just look at the trend. So we're only interested in magnitude of your computation time rather than very accurate, for example, how many seconds, how many hours, how many seconds, right? So this, for those of mathematician problem like this one, because this gave a very formal definition for big O notation. But if you are not a mathematician or you are not interested in the mathematical, you don't need to worry about the definition. So I just give you some rough idea. So for example, we need to do some algorithm analysis, which is not covered in this unit. All right, so you don't need to worry about how to do algorithm analysis. You only need to know the concept. All right, algorithm analysis concept. That's it. That's all you need to do in this unit. So if you want to learn more, then you should, there are some lot of tutorial textbook available. But unfortunately, there's no subject unit to be offered in QUT. Right, for example, I just give you guys an example. For example, there is one algorithm, just an example, whose computing time increase, with this big O, we call it big O of one. That's what you mean by this. This means it's constant time. So when the size of problem increase, the computing time will not increase. It's a constant time. So when the size is 100, the computing time is pretty much with the computing for size of 1,000 or maybe 10,000. So this is a constant time. The second one is linear increasing. So when the size of the problem increase, the computing time will increase linearly. So for example, when n equal to 1, we use 1 second. Then when n equals to 2 seconds, for example, or maybe when n equals to 10, let's say take 1 minute, when n equals to 20, just double, all right, double the computing time. So this is the trend, computing time is approximation, not very accurate, right? So the computing time algorithm is increased with this. This is the second algorithm. The first algorithm, the computing time increase with this one. And this is the third one. For example, the computing time of the algorithm increase with n squared. And the third one, I'll give you a diagram, show you the difference. The computing time increase with 2 to the power of 1, which means this exponential. The computing time increase dramatically when the size of n increase. I just gave you some rough idea. So this is a diagram, probably not very accurate, I say. So for example, the bottom one is the constant one, that's n, right? And there is another one, x. Oh, there's no x, anyway. So this is log, there's one here, that's n. So this is linear, and this is log n. And this n times log n, n square, and this is 2 to the power of n. Okay, so this problem, if this is not intuitive enough, I just give you another some idea, give some more concrete idea, some numbers to your guys. Let's say one instruction can be done, can be executed in just 1 microsecond in your computer. Just this is the example, all right, which is very quick, right? Then, and also we assume the size of the problem, the input is 256, which is not very large. Now when we're dealing big data, the size is much, much bigger than this, right? So now we have different algorithm complexities in big O notation, right? So we have different type of the algorithms. We start from top one, for example, log n. Of course, this algorithm is very good. Why? Because very quick in computing time. And also when the size of the problem increase, the computing time increases very slowly. So only for this algorithm, roughly, not very accurate, roughly only take 3 microseconds. If you use, maybe the same problem by different algorithm, let's say the algorithm complexity is log n, it would take 8 microseconds. If we use a linear one, that's a linear, not big O for n, would 0.256. So this is different. This is a millisecond, not a microsecond. This is a millisecond. If n log n, 2 milliseconds, n squared much longer, 65 milliseconds. N squared is still OK. It's not too bad. But the compute time would be increased to roughly 17 seconds, right? If the size of, if we use an algorithm, if we have a design algorithm whose computation complexity in big O notation is the bottom one, which is 2 to the power of n, believe a lot. Some people would not believe it in the first case, but you can do a calculation by yourself. You need to take this amount of time, century, to get a solution. Believe a lot. Okay, actually, I can tell you the tower of Hanoi problem is very expensive. The computation is exponential. If you don't believe the bottom, if you don't believe the data, you can try by yourself after this lecture or maybe practical. So if say we for when number of disks is 2, 3, or even 10, that's okay, no problem. If you increase the size, let's say, to 256, to say how long you have to wait before the program can terminate, probably never terminate. Not never terminate, probably take years or century, you know, to terminate. You just get in there running forever. So never stop. Not never stop, but not very accurate, okay. Yeah, so we're taking a very long, maybe years or maybe century to finish the computation. Sounds unbelievable, that's true. You can converse, you can try the Tower of Hanoi problem, right? It's a working program. You can download and run your computer. You try different size, right? You can see the computing time. You can, you monitor, you observe, you can see, monitor the computing time, right? So this is it. So, let me quickly ramp up algorithm analysis before take a 10 minutes break. So algorithm very, very important. So if you have one problem, you have different solutions, or different solutions, I mean different algorithms. So you don't need to bother actually implement to know the performance of your algorithm, how good or how bad the algorithms are, right? So instead you can do algorithm analysis to see how the algorithm computing time increase. What's the computation in which magnitude, what's the trend for the computation increase? So you can know, you can use the similar idea to work out the resource usage and memory usage, for example, right? So you don't need to bother to implement them. Then you can very quickly do some quick analysis. You know which algorithm, which solution is better than others, right? But unfortunately, algorithm analysis technique is not covered. So we just only give you a very brief introduction to algorithm analysis. And also, apart from big O notation, there are some other techniques. Big O notation is just one of the many methods for algorithm analysis, but it's the most popular one. All right. Any quick questions before we take a 10 minutes break? We'll come back and talk about algorithms. Okay, 10 minutes break. All right, so we move to the next one. So basically, so one thing, okay. One thing I was supposed to mention before the break was, for big O notation, so we need to work out, what's the best performance, worst performance, or average performance in terms of computing time and space utilization for the algorithm, right? So this is something that I was supposed to do before the break. Anyway, now talking about algorithms. So in the second half of today's lecture, we're talking about two categories of the algorithms. The first one will be search algorithm. Search algorithm, sometimes called searching algorithm. So I use the word interchangeably. So there are two search algorithms. One is called linear search, another one is called a binary search. Okay, so search algorithm basically, as you know, basically giving, for example, a list of data, you need to find, and given a key or given a value, you need to find if the element is in the list or not. So basically, this is what a searching algorithm is about, right? So two categories of algorithm, linear search and binary search algorithm. Linear search, so basically, is a sequential, you know, sequential looking for the data in a list. So we look at the data one by one to say, starting from the first one. I just give you an example. I use this one as an example. So this should be very easy to your guys, right? So for example, we have a list of integers and the key where the data or the whatever you call the key we're looking for is 90. So we start from the first one. This could be an array, could be a vector, could be a linked list. So this is just abstraction. Right, so we start from the first one, we'll compare with the first one because the one we're looking for is 90. So it's 90, no. So we move to the next one. It's not 90, we move to the next one, and next one, and next one until we find it. So when we find it, so we simply, for example, return the index or the location. For example, for this one, return 4, right, back to the coding method. That's very easy, right? Another case, so this time we are looking for one which does not exist. For example, the one we are looking for is 28. We still need to always start from the first one, next one, third one, next one, until we have searched all the elements. So if we cannot find the element in the list, then we return minus one. Minus one indicating the one we're looking for is not in the list, right? So this we call a linear search. Very easy. Some of you probably already used that one already. So the algorithm, so very quickly, so this also return minus one. So this is basically the algorithm in pseudocode, right? This is the algorithm in pseudocode. So from the first one, for when I equals to 0 to n minus 1, right, we do the comparison. If match up, return the index. Otherwise, keep going, keep going. If we have searched through, but we didn't find the element, then we return minus 1. Right, so this is the linear search algorithm. Right, this algorithm is not a program in pseudocode. Now, talking about next one, because we are spending more time talking about sorting algorithms or sort algorithms, right? So quickly go through this one. Linear algorithm is very simple, right? So I don't think we spend too much time. Binary search is a different, by the way, for linear algorithm, as you can see from here, the element in the list, random, not sorted, right? Not in any order. Right, it's perfectly fine for linear search. We don't need to do that, right, for linear search. Where for binary search is different, you know, if we want to use binary search in a list, the list must be sorted. Okay, if not sorted, you cannot use binary search. Okay, why? You will know why in a minute, you know, the reason in a minute. So I use this as an example to demonstrate the basic idea behind a binary search algorithm. Binary search, as you can see, again, the precondition is the list is sorted. So as you can see, the number is sorted in ascending order, right? It's sorted. Now, for example, if we are looking for 16, right? 16, which is there, but we cannot see, right? The program cannot see, right? So if we're looking for 16, what we do is we use a binary search. So we need to use two variables. We then need to use first and last. So initially, first pointed to the first one, the index of the first element, which is 0. So this is 0. And last, of course, last item, index is 9. And then, okay, we calculated the middle element, which is the middle element. We calculate the middle element, that's the first plus last divided by 2, integer operation. So 0 plus 9 divided by 2 integer operation gives four, right? Four, which is a four element, which is the element at the four, this pole. This is the element at the four, right? So we compare 16 with the element in the middle element, which is 23, right? Because 16 is less than 23, and this list is sorted. So if 16 is in the list, it has to be on the left-hand side, right? Because that's the middle element. So in this way, so every time we do a comparison, you know, like we do a comparison, we compare this one with that one, then we can cut the search space by half. So in the rest of the search, we don't need to worry about the right-hand side of the list. Why? Because all the elements are greater than 23 and therefore greater than 16. So it should not be in the right hand side. It has to be, if it's in the list, it has to be in the left-hand side, on the left-hand side, right? So we do that. So we use the idea recursively. So we compare with this one, because it's smaller. So we concentrate the left-hand side, you know, which is, if you look at my cursor, from 0 to 3, right? So what we do is, we didn't change first. First was 0, and still 0. We only change the last, right? This time we only change the last. Last equals to the middle minus 1. Middle index was 3. Middle index is 4 minus 1 gives 3. So we only search this area, the left-hand side. All right? We use the same idea. We use the idea recursively here. So we find the middle element. How to find the middle element? First plus last divided by 2. Integer operation, which gives 1. So the middle element is this one, 11. So we'll compare 16 with 11. Because 16 greater than 11, right? So if 16 is in the list, then it has to be between that one and that one, right? So this time, what we do is we don't change the last. Last still this one, we change it first. How to change it first? The current middle, which is 1 plus 1, gives 2. So first will become 2, last still 3. So this is the middle one. Because it's larger, so we need to update first and last. So this is after update first and last. So if 16 is in the list, it must be between position 2 and position 3. We still use the idea. Okay, we use the idea recursively. So we use the idea again. So first plus last divided by 2 gives 2. This is 2. Right? So we return 2 because 2 is the index for the element that we're looking for, we're searching for. This is 16. So this is the binary search, right? So as you can see, binary search is more efficient than linear search. Why? Because every time we do a comparison, we cut the search space by half. But it's also coming with a price, which is for linear search, the needs does not, you know, not necessarily, you know, we don't have to, you know, sort them in advance. If we want to binary search, the list must be sorted. All right, so this is the one. Just to use another example demonstrating what happens if the element is not in the list, right? So as you can see, the one now we are looking for is here, top is 15, right? It's 15, which as you can see, is not in the list, right? Then how the algorithm can terminate, when and how the algorithm terminates, right? So we use a similar idea. So in the very beginning, this is the beginning, first equals to 0, last equals to 9, the middle is 4. So we compare the one in the middle because 15 less than 23, so we concentrate on the left-hand side, so all you can do is to change last, right? We don't need to change, we can change to first. First remains 0, but last change into 1, 4 minus 1, right, which is 3. So this is the situation. Change pretty much the same with last one. Now we found the middle element, The middle element is 1, so we compare with the, in the middle element, which now is 11 at position 1. So because 15 is greater than 11, so we concentrate on the right-hand side of 11. So that's why, so we need to change first. So first, now change into 2, and last still 3. So middle element, which is this, 16, but 15, now 15 less than 16, right? As a result, so if we want to do search, we use the idea, always use the idea, we use the idea recursively. So we should search the element on the left-hand side of 16. So we need to update last. How do we update the last? Last always the middle minus 1. So as a result, we'll get this. So now first greater than last. So if the condition is true, we terminate. And then we return minus 1, indicating the element is not, we're looking for is not in the list. All right? So this is the termination condition. So when first greater than last, we terminate. Okay? So this is what I'm trying to. Any questions about the two? Oh, this is just a demonstrated the search space, you know, which we are talking about again. Now I can tell you this we call the binary search tree, but I don't want to use the concept at this stage to confuse your guys. Anyway, this is just a demonstrate, you know, the search space of the problem. Okay. Now this is the pseudocode for binary search, right? So as you can see, so this is the initialization. Initially first equal to 0, and last equals to minus 1, because the element in the list start from 1, right? From 0, sorry. So this is a condition, right? If the condition is true, always do the search, always repeat comparison, and then update the first or last, right? And then comparison, next round comparison, next round comparison. So every time we do that, we cut the search space by half, right? So this is the termination condition. When first less than or equal to last, then we keep doing that. When the condition becomes false, we do this. We return minus 1 and terminate program. Okay, that's the one we work out. What's the middle element position, the first plus 1 divided by 2. This is the integer operation, and then we do the comparison. If they match up, return the position, which is the middle. Otherwise, we check, you know, is it greater than or less than. Greater than, if less than, then we, you know, change last, right? Otherwise, we change first, right? So that's the idea. It's pretty simple. Okay. Okay, just a quick summary. So basically, for search, we have two type of search algorithm, linear search, binary search. Binary search, linear search, they need, it's okay, it could be random, but if you use a binary search, it must be sorted, right? So this is the quick summary for us. Any quick questions about these two search algorithms? Okay? All right. Good, so we move to the last section today, which is cover quite a few algorithms, sorting algorithm, so I have to talk on very quickly. So sorting algorithm basically is used for rearrange the element, the order of the element in a list, right? It could be rearranged such that the element in a list is an ascending order, could be descending order. Right. So typically, in this lecture, always sort them by in ascending order. Right. There are quite a few very popular sorting or sort algorithms. Right. So those are the just a list of the algorithms. The basic ones, for example, have selection sort, which I will talk about in next. Right. Insertion sort, bubble sort. Those are the basic sorting algorithms. So basic algorithms are very easy in concept. The idea is very easy to understand and also very easy to implement. But the algorithm is not very quick compared with those advanced algorithms, right? When I say the algorithm not very quick, I mean the computational complexity, the computational complexity of those algorithms are higher, are more complicated, are higher than those, right? So those are very quick, but of course they also got a problem too, right? Maybe the algorithm is very hard to implement, or maybe there are some other deficiencies as well, anyway. So the one I'm going to talk about next, I'll talk about all the basic sorting algorithms. I don't think I have time to talk about all the popular advanced sorting algorithms. So instead, I probably can only talk about quick sort algorithm and merge sort algorithm. By the way, this quick sort algorithm is probably the most popular one. That is the one that implemented in C++ class library. That one. Why? Because it's very quick, right? Performance is pretty good, right? Okay, let's talk about them one by one, starting with basic sorting algorithms. The first basic sorting algorithm we call insertion sort. So why we call it insertion sort? Because the fundamental, the basic operation that is used in this algorithm is insertion, right? So we always use insertion. That's the basic operation we use in this algorithm. That's why we call it insertion algorithm. Okay, how to use insertion as a basic operation to do the sorting? Okay, so the basic idea is, I still want to use an example to demonstrate the idea. So as you can see in the top of the slide, on the slide, the top of the slide, there are a list of integers which are stored in a list, right? So now our job is to put them in ascending order. This is what I'm going to do. Using insertion sorting algorithm. Okay, so the basic idea behind the insertion, okay, this is very, very important for you to understand this. So once you understand this, you shouldn't have any problem understand insertion sorting algorithm. So basic idea is every time we divided the list into two partitions or two areas, okay, sorted area or an unsorted area, all right? And every time, okay, we have a sorted area, unsorted area, all right? So as their name implies, sorted area, of course, all the elements in the sorted area are sorted, are already put in order. Unsorted, they are not in order yet, right? So the basic idea is in number of iteration, of course, but in each of the iteration, it could be iterated many, many times. In each iteration, we get the element, the first element from the unsorted part. And then we insert the element into sorted part, such that after insertion, the sorted still sorted. Okay? So one iteration, we put one. So next iteration, we get the next element from unsorted list, and then we insert that element into sorted list. Right? After the insertion, we make sure sorted part is still sorted. So this is the fundamental, this is the basic idea behind the insertion. This is why this algorithm is called insertion sorting, all right? Now, how to apply this idea? So this is what we do. So initially, let's say, in general, we have n element, right? In general, we have n element. Now we break it down into sorted and unsorted. Initially, the sorted part contains only one element. Because it only contains one element, of course it's sorted, right? One element always sorted, right? So now if you look at the highlighted part, this is sorted. And the rest are unsorted, all right? So this is the initial, right? So we have sorted, we have unsorted, right? Now in the first iteration of the insertion sort, we get to the first element. This is the first element, right? So there's underscore of that, this is the first element. Now we insert into sorted area such that after insertion is still sorted. So I will tell you how to do that in a minute in detail. But after that, just ignore the detail how to do the insertion. But after insertion, should look like this, right? See, still sorted, unsorted. All right. So this is the end of the first iteration. End of the first iteration, in the sorted area, total number of elements increased by one. At the same time, the total number of elements of the unsorted decreased by one. Right. So in the next iteration, we do the same. We always get the first element, which is 45 this time. We insert the 45 into the sorted area. So this is the situation after the insertion, right? So this is the sorted, unsorted areas. And the next, we use the same idea. 23 after insertion, this is the situation. And the next one, 9 after insertion, this is sorted. And eventually, as you can sort it, all sorted, the size of unsorted part becomes zero. So, which means we have sorted. So this is the basic idea behind the insertion operation, right? Now we look at how to actually insert an element into a sorted area such that after insertion is still sorted. So this is the problem we need to address, right? So this diagram is showing how to do that. So for example, currently, so I can see this is sorted, right? This is the element that I'm inserting into the sorted area, this is 23. What we do is, we put 23 in a temporary variable, for example here, temporary variable, and start with the last element. Okay, that's very important, not from the first. Start from last element in the sorted area. Okay, we compare to say, for example, because 23 is smaller than, for this particular instance, because 23 is smaller than 45, so its position must be before 45, right? So we move 44, because we have already copied 23 to a temporary variable, so we can override 23. So after override 23, so this is the situation, right? And then we compare 23 with this one, with 39. With 39 also greater than 23, so 23 is the final position should be before 39. So we need to move 39. So we use 39 to cover these 45. This move. So this is the situation after move 39, right? And then we need to keep going when you compare this one with 11. Because 11 is less than 23, so now we simply put this one here. This is the final position for 23. So this is how insertion is done. All right. So now we have the idea. We have no insertion. So we can easily write the algorithm. Yes.
So it uses the one same array.
One array. There. We do. That's right. We only use R1. So we didn't use any other arrays. The same array, right? But we use a temporary variable here. That's the only additional resource that we used, right? So work on the same array. We don't need to copy from element from one array to another. No, we don't need to do that. We do, right? So this is the algorithm. So as you can see, we use the same array. We don't use any other arrays, right? So why start from 1, because initially we have two areas sorted, which contains one element. So we start from the second element, right? So that's why we start from, what's the index for second element? 1. That's why we need to start 1, right? So this is how to do the insertion. So we needed to, as I have already shown you in the previous diagram, we need to use a temporary variable. So we copy the one that we are inserting into a temporary variable, which one? That's the index 1, index I, right? In general, first time of course 1, right? And then we do the comparison. So this is the condition. All right. So we do, if the condition is true, if j greater than equals to 0 and a temporary less than xj, then we move, right? And this once we found the right position, we copy the time frame back to here, the position, right? So this is the idea. Any questions before I move to next sorting algorithm? Sorry. Okay, good. Oh, by the way, there is a very good demo over there. So in YouTube, you know, there is a dancing, you know, they use a, you know, Romania dancing, you know, to demonstrate how insertion algorithm works, right? Which I think is very helpful. But unfortunately, number one, because I don't have time to show you guys here, but there's a link over there, so you can do that after lecture, maybe at home, maybe in the class, in the particle. It's up to your guys, all right? And number two reason is there's some copyright problem. So even if I give your guys a demo, so I cannot get it recorded, otherwise there are some IP problem. Okay, so because of those reasons, I have to leave this one to your guys. Okay, now I'm talking about, I said I will introduce three basic sorting algorithm to your guys. Okay, now the second one. First one was insertion. Why call it insertion again? Because the fundamental operation used in the sorting algorithm is insertion. Now we have another one. So you should have got some idea. You call it selection. Why is it called selection sort? Because we use a selection as the fundamental operation to put the element, to rearrange the element, or to put the element in order, in ascending order. All right? So the idea is pretty simple. Again, I'm using the idea to show you how to how selection sort algorithm works, right? So selection actually is pretty straightforward. In the first iteration, so again I use the same one. So this is a list which contains a number of integers that are not put or arranged in any order, right? So in the first iteration, we use a selection. We select the minimal, the smallest element, the minimal element in the list. Again, we don't look at how in very detail. I just tell you, somehow we found the smallest element in the list, which is, for this instance, is 9, right? Because this is the smallest element, so the final position for this guy is position 0, first one, right? So once we found this one, so we swap. But currently, this position is occupied by 39. So we swap. So after swap, this is the situation after swap. Okay, so now this is the one we call the one iteration. So there are actually two operations, not just the selection. So we actually use two operations. Selection followed by swap if necessary. Sometimes we don't need a swap, right? Because we find, okay, this is the, for example, first one and first element is the smallest element and already in the first place, right? So we don't need to do any swap at all. But it's essential to selection, right? Selection, swap if necessary. So this is the situation. So after the first round of selection and swap, we put the smallest element or the minimal element in the its final position. Now in the rest of sorting process, we don't need to worry about this one anymore. Because it has already been put its final position. Now what we do is we just work on, so this is sorted area, this is unsorted. We use for the unsorted part, we use the same idea. So in the, you know, for those unsorted element, which one is the smallest? 11. 11 is already in the final position, so we don't need to, you can do swap itself, or don't do the swap at all, depending on your implementation details. All right? For the consistency, we still swap, but swap itself, right? Which is not actually not necessary to do that. And then the third iteration, we do the same. So in the third iteration, in the beginning of the third iteration, or in the beginning of the third round of selection and swapping, two elements already put into their final destination. Now in the unsorted area, we find the smallest one. which for this instance is 18, right? So 18. We swap, this is situation of the swap, right? This is the third round, and we use the same idea, the first round, and so on and so forth. Eventually, as you can see, they are put in order. So this is the basic idea behind selection sort, all right? So selection algorithm description, all right? Now we look at the details. So for example, how to do selection and how to do swapping, right? So here, there's a diagram. This, again, this algorithm, this is not a program. So from 0 to m minus 1, you know, so we use our index, we put this one over there. So this is used to store the index of the smallest element in the unsorted part, in the unsorted area. You know. And this is the smallest, the minimum item is a temporary variable, right? So initially, we put, for example, each iteration will start initially, for example, this is the 0, and this is the first element in the first iteration, right? So this is used to, this for loop is used to find the minimum element, right? That should be very simple, right? So we're starting from the first element in the unsorted area. If next one is smaller, then we change, right? We update this, update the minimum index, and also update the minimum item. If it's greater than, we don't need to worry about move the next one. If it's smaller, we update, right? So at the end of the for loop, then we find the minimum one. So this is swap, right? This selection swap, right? So that's the idea, okay? Now, the third fundamental, the basic sorting operation, which is also a very popular one, is called a bubble sort, okay? Bubble sort, again, because of time limitation, I directly use the idea. Bubble sort, what's the basic idea used in the bubble sort algorithm? This is based on one observation, which is, that's very important, all right? Which is, if a list is sorted, or all the elements are put in order, if and only if, for any consecutive element, for any pair of consecutive elements in the list are sorted, are already in order. So you just randomly pick up, for example, randomly pick up the two elements which are next to each other. If any pair of, neighbors are sorted, then that is sorted. That list is sorted. Otherwise, it's not sorted. So this bubble sort is sort of exchange sorting algorithm. Why? Because exchange is the basic operation used in this algorithm. So you have already know insertion, right? Insertion because fundamental operation is insertion. Selection, fundamental operation is selection. Where for bubble sort, the fundamental operation used here in bubble sort is exchange. Okay, I'll show you how to do exchange, right? Again, the observation is very important, right? So if, again, just to repeat, if the element in the list are sorted, right? If and only if for any pair of consecutive element, they are already in order. If there exists any element that not in order, any pair of element which is next to each other are not in order, then that list is not sorted. So this is based on this observation, okay? So based on this observation, so now if we use a bubble sort to put this element in order, this is how, right? So we start, you can start from the beginning, but typically we start from the very end of the list, all right? So we compare to say if they are in order, if this one is smaller, yes, they are in order, we don't need to worry about that. And then next pair, which is this, which is this one with that one, next pair, next to each other, right? They are in order, they are not in order. Okay, we exchange, so this is the exchange. This is the situation after extension. 9 have moved to here. This is 23. We do the same. 9 with 45, are they in order? No. We exchange. Actually, we swap, we exchange, right? The similar idea. 11, there's a 9, 11, so not in order, change. Not in order, exchange. So at the end of the first round of exchanges operation, exchange operation, we actually, by doing that, we can guarantee to put the smallest element or minimum element in the first position. And that is final position for this one, right? So in the rest of the sorting process, we don't need to worry about element 9 because it's already moved to its final position. Then starting from here in the secondary iteration, we use the idea recursively, right? Start from here, we put, we use exchange to put the second smallest element in its position, right? So just to show you. Right, so this is the situation after the second iteration. So because we don't have time to look at the details of the process. And then the third iteration, this is the situation after the third iteration of exchanging, and the fourth and finally iteration. So as you can see, they are sorted, right? So this we call the bubble sort algorithm. Now, any questions about this? Okay, this is algorithm description. So this algorithm description. So I have to leave this one to you guys. This is pretty straightforward. Now, because we have another two algorithms to introduce before we can ramp up today's lecture, right? Because one of them will be used in today's practical. So we must guarantee we can finish that. All right, so that's why. So I have to leave this one to your guys. But again, there is a demo over there which can help you to understand the algorithm. Now, I move to the next one, which we call the quick sort algorithm. This probably is the most popular and the most important algorithm called the quick sort algorithm. It's a sort of advanced algorithm. The basic idea, so as you know, divided and conquer is a problem solving technique, right? So in order to handle a very large, complex problem, we divide it into smaller pieces and we sort them, you know, individually, and then finally put it together to form a solution to the original problem. So this is the basic idea behind divide and conquer algorithm, right? So for the sorting algorithm, for the quick sort algorithm, so there are one process which is very, very important called partition. Or partitioning, they call partition. Now I call partition here in my presentation. The partition basically is a sort of a divided and a conquer process. So basically, the idea is, in order to solve this problem, put those elements in this big problem, right? In this array, I divided this one into two smaller ones, and then I put the smaller ones. Element in two smaller ones in order. Right, this is the idea. Okay, now the question is, how can I break it down, quickly break it down a problem into two smaller problems of the same type? This is the key point, right? This is done by partitioning, right? So how the partitioning is done, I tell you. Okay, this is very important to understand. So first of all, I pick up an element, typically the first element as a pivot. Okay, let's say it's a 5. I will use this one. I will put all the elements that are greater than or equal to 5 to the left-hand side in the list. And I put all the elements that are less than or maybe equal to 5 to the right-hand side of the list. And that's not all. I can guarantee I put a 5, you know, because the current one is a 5 pivot. I will put the pivot element which currently is a 5 to its final destination, final position in the sorted list. This is the partition process about. Okay? Now we look at how to do that. Okay, so we need to use two pointers or two variables, whatever you call, right? So for the two pointers, something like that. So initially, this is a pivot. This is pointed to the second element. This is pointed to upper. We have a lower, upper, pointed to the last element, lower, the second element, right? And then, very important, otherwise you may confuse yourself. Starting from the left-hand side, starting from lower, I'm trying to find the element which is greater than the pivot. Three is smaller, so we don't need to worry about it because eventually I want to put all the element that less than five on the left-hand side. Three is already there. Smaller than five. It's already on the left-hand side, so I don't need to worry about this. So I'm trying to find out one starting from left-hand side to the right-hand side. Okay, the order is very important, and also direction is also important. I'm trying to find out one which is greater than five. Now, nine is greater than five. Then I stop over there. And then from right-hand side to left-hand side, I'm trying to find out one which is smaller than five. Eight is greater than five, so I don't need to worry about it. I move to the next one. Okay, four is smaller than five. So four's final position should be in the left-hand side, right? So what do I do is I swap. So that's why quick sort algorithm is also called exchange algorithm. So I do exchange it, so I exchange their position. So this is the position after exchange. Say four has been moved to this position, nine has moved to that position. And after that, I do the same. I move, for example, lower to next one, upper to next one. I'm doing the same thing. I'm trying from left-hand side to the right-hand side. I'm trying to find out one which is greater than five. So six is greater than five. I stop. I don't need to move forward, right? Because I already got that one which is greater than five. And then I stop over there. And then from right-hand side to left-hand side, I'm trying to find that one which is smaller than five. And why smaller than five? Exchange. So this is the situation after exchange. I do the same. Until I come to this position. If I come to this position, I cannot, have really, do the exchange. Then I put five in the middle. Which position should I put? This is something related to implementation details. Actually, I also do exchange, but this exchange, I change the pivot, which is the first element, always the first element, in the counter list, with the one pointed by upper, right? Because lower should always we terminated the process. We find a pair and exchange. So when should we terminate the process? We terminate the process when upper less than lower. So if you look at here, lower less than upper, lower less than upper, less than lower, then we terminate. And then we swap what? Swap the pivot element, which is the first element, with the element pointed by upper. So this is the situation, right? So as you can see here, this is the first iteration, first round of iteration. So number five, it has already been moved to its final position. And all the elements on left-hand side less than or maybe equal to five, all the elements on right-hand side are greater than or equal to five. Right? I have done that. Okay, in the rest, I use the idea recursively. So I use the idea recursively to put them in order and also use the idea recursively to put those in order. Right? So just to quickly show the process before I quickly talk about the last one. So next, because of five, we have already put in order, right? So working on this, how to work on that, pivot, if you look at the private step, pivot was one. So I use a pivot to break it down into two. This all the element on the left-hand side of two are less than or equal to two. All the element on the right-hand side are greater than or maybe equal to two. So they are still unsorted, but this is sorted, right? And I use the idea on this one because there's only one item. Of course, it's sorted. And then we use the similar idea, which is currently the pivot is four right? And this is situation. Pivot is 4, we put 4 here, and left hand side is 3. And eventually, so, and then finally, we work on this part, 3 contains only one item, it's sorted, so it's sorted. So now we use the same idea to sort all the element on the left hand side. And then we use the same idea to sort the element on the right hand side. And after that, sort it, right? So this is the basic idea behind a quick sort algorithm. Now, finally, I got 5 minutes time to talk about, very quickly, talk about one, sorry, I'm not able to take any questions for today. If any question, I can answer your question in the early of next week, right? So because of time limitation. One final sorting algorithm is about merge sort, okay? Merge, the basic operating used is merging. So how to merge, right? So, okay, very important, precondition is if we have already got a two sorted list, this is just an example, let's say L1, L2, they must be sorted, so they are sorted, right? As you can see, they are sorted. Now we use a merge operation to put all the elements in the two lists together to form one sorted list. And the one sorted list is put in a new one, which is L3, right? So how to do that? Very easy. I use two pointers, one for each. We use X, pointing to the first element initially, first element in L1, first element Y pointed to the first element in L2. I do the comparison to see which one is smaller. Because this one is smaller, I copy one to the new list, right? And then after that, I move this one to the next one, so point it to 3, right? Now I do the same. I compare which one is smaller, 2 is smaller, I copy 2, and move the pointer to the next position. So this is the situation. And then always compare the two elements, which one is smaller, I always copy the smaller one to the new list, right? So this is the situation. Right, so now currently this element is pointed by X is 6, this is 4, this is smaller, I copy 4. I copy this one, then I move the pointer. I don't need to move this pointer, right, so I move that pointer. So I pointed to 5 and 6, which is smaller, of course 5. Copy 5, I move the pointer to the next one, right. And this time 6, 7, smaller, copy 6. So that's one situation I need to mention to your guys, right? So now I have already copied, copied all the elements in L1 into the new element, a new list L3. But we still got some element left in, as you can see, in L2. In this situation, we don't need to do a comparison anymore. Instead, we simply copy the rest element into L3, right? Because they are already sorted. Right, so we simply copy. So this is the situation after this one, right? This is a merge operation. The precondition is we have two already sorted lists. We put them together to form one sorting list. Okay, you're probably asking me, how could I use this one to sort an array? All right, how to use that one? Okay, so this is how to use that one. I use this one as an idea. Use this one. Initially, we took an algorithm, took a quick look at the algorithm first, right? So this is the algorithm, merge sorting algorithm. So there must be sorted L1, L3, right? This is the merging algorithm. This is for merging, all right? For merging only. This is not the sorting algorithm. This only merge two to form one sorting list. This is the one we just look at, right? And now, how to use this is actually the sorting algorithm. Okay, it's pretty wordy, so I just want to use this one as an example to demonstrate how the merge sort algorithm works, all right? So, as you can see from the top, it's unsorted, right? The list is unsorted, it's not sorted. How to use the merge sort algorithm? First of all, I divided it into two. cut in half, you know, roughly. Sometimes if an even number or it's an odd number, not even, but roughly in half, you know, equal size, right? And then I try to use a merge algorithm, right? But this one, if you just look at left-hand side of Y, we use the same idea to deal with the right-hand side. We only look at the left-hand side of Y, right? For this one, it's still not sorted, so we cannot use merging. If we use merging, it must be sorted. Otherwise, we cannot use merge operation. That's the precondition for using merge operation. So we still need to further break it down into two. So these are four elements. We'll break it down to each, so two elements. This is not sorted. This is not sorted. We cannot use the sorting algorithm. Merge operation, right? So we need to further break it down until each of the element, each of the list contains only one element. So, because one element is sorted, right? One element always sorted, right? So this is sorted. We use a merge operation to form a new one, which is sorted. We use this one to form a new one sorted. Similarly, sorted. We use the merge operation to form a new list, which contains, see, these two elements and then also sorted. So now this is sorted. This is also sorted. We can use the merge operation to form a new list, which is also sorted. We can use the same idea to put the other four elements in order. And finally, this is sorted and this is sorted. We put them together using the merge operation, so we got sorted. So this is how merge sort algorithm works. Okay? Okay, probably running out of the time now. I probably can take one very quick question if you guys have any. Or if you don't have any questions, thanks. See you. Oh, by the way, next week is an inter-semester break, so there's no lecture. All practical, right? Sorry, I'll come to you later.